So what does Roche see when we say personalized healthcare? We have Miss Anur Sek from Belgium here, who will tell you more about their vision. Here you go.
Thank you. So yes, my name is Anouk Serk. I am currently the strategy and innovation lead at Roche Slovakia, and I'm very excited. I'm very honored to give you this presentation about both the challenges and the beauty that lies within personalized healthcare. I do think we really are at a start of a revolution. I think you can even compare it to what internet did to the way we work, the way we communicate, the way we collaborate. The same thing is true for personalized healthcare. If we project ourselves into a couple of decades later, this way of working, this way of healthcare is going to change the healthcare, the ecosystem dramatically. So I'm very excited to share with you what does it concretely mean, health, personalized healthcare, and why it is so important. So let's start maybe with the challenges of the healthcare. There are four main challenges. First of all, the knowledge acceleration. I think you've noticed this as well. If you put yourself in the 1950s, actually the medical knowledge doubled every 50 years. Nowadays, the medical knowledge doubles every 72 days. So I'm going to repeat this. This means the medical knowledge every 2 or 3 months is doubling. So imagine the medical knowledge there is for you as a pharmacy student now, and the medical knowledge that will be available when you finish college. It is unprecedented. And that is a real challenge. Talk to any physician in Slovakia or across the world, it is a challenge to keep up to date with this medical knowledge. The second challenge is the disease complexity. The more you know about a disease, the more you also understand how limited you know. And if we just take an example of cancer, there are 200 tumor types, which sounds manageable. But if you look then, every tumor type can have up to 1.2 million mutations. And every mutation means that a potential other treatment should be considered. Every mutation has a different prognostic, has a different strategy behind it. The third challenge is also diagnosing diseases. Previously, you would just have a blood sample maybe and a medical history and an anamnesis. Now you have tons of X-rays, MRIs, blood samples, blood pressure, but also comprehensive genomic profiling. And it adds to the complexity of making the right diagnosis. And the fourth one, and it's not the least one, is how do we manage all this information? So you have so many data points now, so many different information, and they're all located at different places. How do we manage to get a holistic, integrated view of all this patient information in order to move forward with the right treatment and right patient care? So those are the challenges, but there's also so many opportunities currently. And you are all digital natives, like we say. You are much more used to apps than I am, and than the other generations are, so you know about the opportunities. What are the opportunities that we have to embrace and that really Roche wants to take as a challenge? First, we have this opportunity to better understand the disease. We have those comprehensive genomic profiling at our reach, which are now affordable to better understand the disease, its molecular complexity, and the way to move forward. We see that the patients are a lot more empowered. 2 decades ago, a patient would go to the doctor and would trust what the doctor says. Nowadays, The patient informs himself on internet. He knows the treatment available. He knows the options, and he is a lot more empowered. We also have so many novel technologies, and we might be scared of it. And you might sometimes think, will there still be a role for a pharmacist in the future, or will there still be a role for a doctor? But actually, all those technologies are helping the healthcare practitioners to make better decisions. We see in all countries that the regulations are evolving. We have to evolve. We have to think about data protection. We have to think about how to handle this complex data system. And we have to move to partnerships between different stakeholders. The government alone cannot solve this. Roche definitely cannot solve this alone. So we have to find partnerships and co-create, co-invest, co-manage and co-prepare for a future so that we come with a value-based, outcome-driven healthcare, which will be better for the patient and which will also, worldwide, be more sustainable. So Roche, we are really committed to this. We are committed because we want to partner to find sustainable solutions. We also committed because at Roche, the patient is at the center of what we do and is at the center of every decision. We also have a unique opportunity because, unlike any other pharma company, we have both pharmaceutical and diagnostic in one integrated approach. We have a leading portfolio in different disease areas with high medical need, like oncology, like immunology, like infectious diseases. And we also have a reputation as a trusted partner. So how can we do this? Because it's not easy, yeah? And we won't do it in a year, not in 10 years. It's not a sprint, it's a marathon. How do we do this? How do we leverage all this medical knowledge that is available? How do we leverage all the data that is available? And how do we leverage technology? How do we do it? So to try to explain it in a simple way, we talk about meaningful data at scale. What does it mean? It means we will collect data of different types. So it will be data coming from imaging, data coming from clinical data, data coming from genomic profile reports, and data coming from, for example, wearable devices. If you, like me, already have a watch that measures everything, in the future, all those data points will also be integrated in your information that your doctor can access and that you can access. We will also be able to combine all the different tests that you've done, all the different tests that you've done over the time into one data set point. So not only is the quality of the data is going to be improved, but, and this is where it gets very interesting, your specific profile will be able to be matched with people from around the globe, not only Slovakia, but the globe, with similar molecular profile, similar medical histories, similar symptoms, so that we can learn from every patient around the globe and we can learn and give the best treatment to go forward. So meaningful data at scale, what is it? It's integrating deep and broad data from multiple sources and then connecting it to people or patients around the globe. And this is maybe, if it gets too complex, a visual proposal of what it really means. So I think today we are now at the first image. We tend to give a product to a patient, but we really actually don't really know what this patient needs and what would be the best treatment. So we give the same treatment to all the patients. And the doctor then tries to understand why is it working for one patient and it's not working for another patient. More and more, when we will be able to integrate the comprehensive genomics, all the electronic medical records, the digital health, the advanced imaging, more and more this means the patient you see in front of you, you will have a very clear view of what are the best treatment options to go for this patient. So you go from a blurred image, a one treatment for all, to a very clear image and a tailor-made treatment for every patient. So ideally, this is a closed loop, which means you have all the data. And of course, you can imagine there's so many data available. There's not one single person who can manage all this. So we need, this is what we call advanced analytics. This is artificial intelligence. This is machine learning. This is software that will combine all those data and support the doctor to help them guide for a better treatment. And then again, when a patient is treated, we are registering how is the outcome of the patient. And how is this helping, again, the whole information loop and data loop? So it's complex, it's very challenging. We are not there yet, but we are definitely making a lot of progress. For example, I will share two examples of what we are already doing now and for which are already improving patients' lives. So first is a Capisco trial. So you know what a trial is, you know clinical trial. This is a phase two trial, 800 patients in 20 countries. And it's about a cancer of unknown primary location. So this is very challenging for doctors because you see the metastasis, but you don't find the primary location. So how do you then treat? How do you treat this patient? What we are doing now with this trial is we are putting all those patients in a trial. The current medical need is huge for these patients. Those patients are going through a comprehensive genomic profile to really understand what is the molecular alteration of their tumor. And then they are divided into two groups. One group will receive the standard of care, which is currently chemotherapy. The other group will go into the future way of working, which is a tumor-based multidisciplinary board. What does this mean? It means you will combine an oncologist, a pathologist, a molecular genetician, a radiologist, and you will have this comprehensive diagnostic support tool, the software, who will say, with all the data I have for this patient and connecting it with all the data I know from around the world, those are the treatment options that have the highest likelihood of success for this patient. So this is what we mean with molecular guided target therapy. So we are currently already running those kinds of trials, and those are truly groundbreaking trials which can bring meaningful value for patients. The second example I want to give you is an example in multiple sclerosis. So multiple sclerosis, also a complex disease where traditionally the patient sees only his physician two times a year. That's the blue dots you see. But over the course of the year, a patient who has multiple sclerosis will have symptoms increasing, symptoms decreasing, etc. But when he comes to the physician and the physician asks him, okay, how were the last 6 months? How was it? He doesn't recollect exactly what happened. He's not able always to say exactly 3 months. He was walking a bit slower. He doesn't. So more and more now we have apps that are monitoring their symptoms automatically. This app will register when, for example, the text messages he writes are slower than usually. This app will measure when he walks slower, which might indicate an exacerbation of his symptoms, which then again helps the physician to make a better decision for the future treatment or future pathway for this patient. So those are two examples, concrete examples that we are already now working on to improve personalized healthcare. In the sake of time, I will skip this one, and I maybe just gonna end with an example of traditional versus future. This is an example of a patient who was diagnosed with bladder cancer. He was diagnosed with bladder cancer. Physician gave him some kind of treatment, but he didn't respond well. And on top of that, he had adverse events. The doctors then decided to run through a molecular comprehensive test, which showed that actually his tumor had the same molecular alteration than normally you would see in breast cancer. The doctors, before going through this comprehensive check, would never have thought of giving a breast cancer treatment to this patient. But with this report, seeing the molecular alteration comparable to breast cancer, they totally changed their treatment. They gave two treatments that you would give to a breast cancer patient, and he responded dramatically. So this is the future, and this is how we want to have a treatment that is the right treatment for the right patient at the right time. And this would benefit not only the patients, but you can imagine also the healthcare society from an economic perspective. If we don't give any treatments that are not helping patients, but only focus on treatments that truly have value for patients. So thank you very much. Roche is very committed to this. If you are excited as me about it, don't hesitate to follow us on LinkedIn, on Instagram, on Facebook, because there's a lot more to come in this era.
Thank you very much for this interesting presentation. We have some questions from audience. First, what is your opinion on wearable gadgets and its potential in healthcare and prevention? Should it be something we use every day?
The healthcare devices?
Yeah.
Yes. I truly think we will see exponential use of those devices. I understand that people are still a bit worried sometimes about it, which is understandable. I think regulations need to be put in place to protect the privacy of the patients, definitely, and there's still work to do, but it's a European priority as well. So we will work on it from a European perspective. And I do think in 20 years from now, we will use this significantly more as a support for yourself as a patient and the physician to manage your own disease. Yes, so I think there will be significantly more use of this.
Okay, thank you. Second, what are the most advanced technologies Russia has in battle against diseases?
So actually, it's a bit, you can't pinpoint it to one. It's, if you see what Uber does, Uber didn't invent anything. Uber connects the dots. It connects a Google Map with an online payment, with an easy way to move a patient from A to B with existing people. It didn't invent anything. This is a bit what Roche is doing. Roche is connecting the dots. So we are developing high medical need programs. We are partnering up with companies that are specialized in how do we manage all those data, how do we get meaningful insights of those data, and we combine it with partnerships to create better ways forward for the patients. So the technologies, one of the technologies, for example, is a Navify tumor board, which is a tumor board, like you can imagine, like when you see sometimes in the movies where they have an overview of everything. This Navify tumor board has an overview of all your patient history, whereabouts, blood pressure, if you've ever done all the blood tests, your profile, molecular profile. So it has everything. This is Navify tumor board. This is an example Roche developed, and oncologists in different countries are already using to support and guide their treatment decisions.
Okay, now we have one personal question. What motivated you to work in Slovakia?
So I always worked in Roche, Belgium. And at Roche, we are very passionate about bringing diverse people together because we truly believe that having different perspectives challenges you and motivates you and you get to learn. So at Roche, we really try to push people beyond boundaries. So actually, my boss in Belgium, even though I have a family, I have four kids, really pushed me, why don't you try to go on an international assignment? It would be great for the country to have you, but it's great for you to learn as well the cultural differences. And I have to say she was totally right because it has been an incredible experience. I really love Slovakia. I love the nature. I love the people. It's a very welcoming country, and I'm learning so much from everybody at Roche, and I really find it very, very grateful to be part of this international assignment.
Thank you. Here are the questions about the work positions. If you have something for graduates or for someone with PhD in Roche.
So definitely, Roche is always looking for motivated, bright people with a scientific mind, so like you. We currently have a position for a pharmacist internship, but I will leave my colleague will tell. So please listen to my colleague Dasha Derčová tomorrow. She will tell you more about it.
Thank you very much for all the answers and the interesting presentation. We are very happy that we had you here.
Yes, thank you very much for hosting me as well. I was really honored.